Now we're going to return to the theme of leadership. And Sarah Wartell, president of the Urban Institute, is going to lead this final plenary on bold urban leadership.
I'm going to just introduce folks coming down from the far end. So at the far end is Matt Cullen, who is president and CEO of Rock Ventures, which, as he just explained to me, is really the organization under which much of Dan Gilbert's activities in the city of Detroit and the businesses that are operating there work. And he's been a critical partner with the city and with many of the other leaders we've been hearing from and talking about in the city's revitalization. We have Mayor Marc Morial, who is currently president of the National Urban League, so knows a good bit about cities and will, I hope, bring a focus on inclusion to this conversation. But importantly, he was also mayor of another city that was deeply challenged earlier in his career as mayor of the city of New Orleans. Next to him, we have Annise Parker. Mayor Parker was, until just last year, mayor of the city of Houston, which is in many ways quite different than Detroit, but is got really a kind of an exciting demographic mix, exciting relationship with business, but will also, I hope, share with us some thoughts about the differences between different kinds of cities and north and south and some of the different kinds of civic infrastructure we have in different places. And finally, Derek Douglas, who today is vice president for civic engagement at the University of Chicago. I'm pleased to say an old colleague of mine and dear friend, but Derek is here today in particular to bring to us the federal perspective. Derek was in the Domestic Policy Council at the White House when the challenges of the city of Detroit became apparent and the federal government was trying to mobilize to figure out how they could play a supporting role. So we're here to talk about leadership, and we're going to use Detroit as a starting point and then bring in the, try to help for the others around here from different cities, help think about where Detroit is and is not a relevant reference point. And so to do that, I just wanted to first start talk about what we've been hearing over the last couple days are really sort of stages in the evolution of Detroit. And I'm, you know, just in the last decade, certainly this history has long deep roots before that. Because I think the role of the different institutions shifted over time in different stages, and as we think about Detroit moving forward, I think we need to think about whether or not the roles will shift again. So if you think about the phases, really the first phase, starting in about 2007, was when some of the initiatives that we've heard talk about over the last couple days started to be built. And I think of this as a little bit as building infrastructure. So whether 2007, the launch of the New Economy Initiative, 2010 was when the move by Quicken Loans to downtown Detroit happened, was also when Kresge launched with its partners the Detroit Future City that we heard about this morning, and the efforts that Tony described of trial and error to try to get the collective ownership right. Rip, in the essay that was circulated before this, talked about the second period around the bankruptcy as being really almost a period of despair. He wrote that intractable doesn't begin to describe the sense of hopelessness that attended so many people's thinking about the city of Detroit. The third phase, and again, these are not necessarily chronologically perfectly pure, was when the flywheel started to catch, and we heard a lot about that in the last panel. And it was a moment when momentum started to pick up, when smaller initiatives started adding up to bigger things. I think the public amazement in Detroit and elsewhere when the grand bargain happened and people were able to see the city start to emerge from bankruptcy around the country. People observed that with some surprise and it caused a fresh look. Public services, as we heard from Kevin Orr last night, started to improve, not everywhere, but enough so that people noticed and saw the differences. Rock venture investments certainly expanded in properties that they were purchasing, and major financial institutions like J.P. Morgan Chase and Goldman Sachs, as we heard earlier, made or increased their investments, J.P. making a $50 million investment in this city. And you suddenly heard all kinds of news stories talking about hip Brooklynites move into Detroit because the culture of innovation was there and the food scene was great and all of that. But it's the next chapter that may be the hardest. And in work that we're doing with Kresge, we like to call this inclusive recovery. And it is really the time when you need the flywheel to start catching for a broader cross-section of the public in the city, to make sure that the momentum is not only in the downtown or on the corridors, but in the neighborhoods, to make sure that we have the discipline, or we hold public actors accountable to discipline to make hard choices along the lines of the Detroit Future City Plan. And we wrestle with the tensions that this make sure the city works not only for the newer workforce that has been attracted there, but for its long-term residents. And most importantly, I think, and this has been a theme throughout all of these stages, but as we heard Fred Blackwell talk about yesterday, a time when we make sure that we really wrestle and explicitly deal with the city's racial past and its ongoing racial present. And we make sure that we are including and creating a next generation of leadership and deepening the capacity of the next generation of leadership in the city. So we're going to talk a little bit about the roles that different actors play in each of those stages, and mayors, philanthropy, private sector, federal actors, and even anchor institutions. And we really want to understand whether or not the kind of combination of actors, and really I think we've heard over time, I will say this because I think some people can't, that for a while the public sector was not capable of taking up the charge of responding to the sort of deepening crisis in the city. And it was the case that the private sector and philanthropy played the lead role for a period. And then in time, as public leadership came in that was really able to take on that challenge, others started helping to strengthen the capacity of the public sector. That formula may or may not be the right formula for many of the other cities that aren't going through near-death experiences or may have different sets of capacities. What I was hoping we could start to guess this group to talk about is the roles of these different actors in this city and in others that are need for revitalization, and try to help dig into the question of whether or not the Detroit model is exception or an example. So I'm going to start by turning to Matt and Derek from the perspective of the business community and the federal government and ask you about two questions about exception versus example. The first is about the city itself and its challenges and how you see it. Are the lessons here of recovery ones that are possible for other cities to replicate, and were the problems similar or different? And then secondly, whether the model of the actors who came together and how you related to the public sector, was that unique to Detroit, or is that a lesson for communities around the room? Matt?
Well, I'll take the first crack at it. I think Detroit's unique in a lot of ways. I think part of that's probably scale. I mean, just the scale of the problem. Tony talked about it earlier, but the geographic scale, the focus on a single industry, and that industry brought with it a lot of characteristics of kind of low-skilled jobs and unionization. It brought with it a lot of industrialization and a lot of complexities with that. I mean, some people analogize the city of Detroit to like a army base that was never decommissioned because there's this incredible buildup of industrial capacity for World War II, and then suddenly a lot of it was not utilized, and it created tremendous problems. That in turn, you can argue, cause and effect with racial segregation and poverty concentration and a lot of other things taking place. And you ended up with, late 1990s, 2000, almost an abdication of the business and philanthropic community, and then a corrupt political. So if there's a three-legged stool, they were all broken. There was nobody engaging. And I think that you know, unique perhaps in Detroit is that the business and philanthropic came back first, in a sense, and said, we're going to play a role here that's different. We're not going to stand back anymore, and we're not going to watch the city go away, and we're going to do it respectfully relative to everybody's roles and so on, but we're going to play a role probably of a, you know, deeper and broader than is typical for those two legs of the stool. And then and we were able to sort of, using the flywheel analogy, get things going a little bit. And then of course, when Mayor Duggan came in and Warren Evans and Kevin Orr and all of those good things, suddenly we had a partner that was more than capable of fulfilling the role that the city and the elected government needs to play. And I think it was that kind of energy when all three were actually firing together, which had been a long, long time since that had been the case, that has made such a profound difference, I think.
I want to come back and ask you about the role of the business community in these latter stages with a more capable public sector. But first, let me ask you, Derek, how do you look at the city from the White House?
Well, I would say from the White House perspective, I mean, Detroit was unique, but it wasn't unique. Detroit, in some respects, the way we viewed it at the time, it was kind of symbolic of what was happening around the country in many cities. I live now in Chicago on the South Side. If you look at the economic challenges that the South Side of Chicago faces, they're very similar to what Detroit is facing. If you look at unemployment, poverty, crime, you go through, I actually had some folks do matching statistics. It's almost the same. But what Detroit had was, because of the historical importance of the city to this country over time, it enabled the federal government, those of us in the White House who wanted to work on cities, to really lift it up as a place to focus on first, but then to build an initiative around it that reached many more cities. So what we did a lot of things, but the one that we focused on the most was this initiative called Strong Cities, Strong Communities. And in many respects, Strong Cities, Strong Communities, Detroit was the inspiration for that initiative. And we saw what was happening in Detroit. The president saw what was happening in Detroit. Nobody wanted to see Detroit hit those issues while we were there and proud to do something about it. But when you looked at the supports that were needed for Detroit, you know, fixing the way the federal government related to cities, trying to have the government be more of a partner, trying to allow the funds to connect better when they hit the ground, providing technical assistance where people actually can go work side by side with cities, philanthropy, and the other stakeholders. We didn't just do it in one city. We actually did it in New Orleans, was in the original, Cleveland. There were several cities that we did the same model that had the same needs. But Detroit, because of the historical importance and because of the way philanthropy and the private sector and others were coming together, allowed, I think, a vehicle for us to hold up as a model for this kind of partnership.
And I think it's important to, correct me if I'm wrong about this, the SC2 commitment to Detroit happened before the bankruptcy.
That was before the bankruptcy.
In other words, the people understood that Detroit was, you know, teetering on the brink, and that, especially as the economy was tanking, that a lot of our cities were facing these same set of issues. And the bankruptcy ended up becoming a focal point for a lot of public attention from the rest of the country, but there was a commitment to Detroit long before that.
So this was well before the bankruptcy, and you know, I remember actually I was in a Starbucks. So people had been thinking about it, but I remember I was in a Starbucks and I picked up the paper. I can't remember if it was the New York Times or the Washington Post, but there was an article about Detroit on the front page. And in the article, there was a person, a resident from Detroit, quoted, and the quote said something like, why can't we have the things that other people have in other cities? And I remember reading that saying, you know, this is the first African-American president in the history of the United States. You have a city like Detroit that's crumbling. We cannot sit idly by and do nothing. And that's led to conversations with Sean, calls to Rip Rapson, to get reality checks on what's going on, what can we do, and that led to the initiative. After the bankruptcy, though, there was another wave where, I think with Gene Sperling and others, there was this whole other kind of effort with a lot of money and a lot of resources put in to try to do it, but same motivation.
So I want to turn to our mayors for a second. As you hear this story told of the role that philanthropy and the private sector played in laying the groundwork, creating some infrastructure, the neural networks between the different parts of the three legs of the stool, how do you think about that from the mayor's seat? Is that kind of infrastructure, can that in most cities be led from outside of government, or should the mayor be the architect of that infrastructure?
You want me to
either
first?
Mark, why don't you begin?
Depends on the mayor.
There we go, the honest answer. The honest answer.
I mean, it's fundamental. It depends on the mayor and the credibility and the skill set and the power that the system of government gives. But the most important thing is, and we should keep this, keep our eye on the word partnership. Because in a healthy community, there is an ongoing partnership between the business leadership, the philanthropic leadership. If the community has a labor, community, faith-based leadership. Now within that, there's gonna be a lot of tension and a lot of give and take. The challenge is when people withdraw because they can't get their way, or they withdraw because they feel that coming to the table empowers them to dictate. I always thought it was about building a partnership, and that partnership involved tension, creative, productive tension and debate and discussion about the future. Detroit's situation, and I think when I look at it, it is either an aberration or it's a foreshadowing, right? Mm-hmm. So it's an aberration because the uniqueness of Detroit is that in 1957, Detroit had the highest median income of any American city. If you look at 1975 to 1980, Detroit had the largest number of African-American businesses on the Black Enterprise Top 100 list. Detroit, however, was built around a single industry. So with that, there was risk. But it was also a single industry where trade and fiscal policies shifted manufacturing abroad, the importation of vehicles, and then ultimately, it was the development of foreign auto manufacturers who populated in places like the South where they were away from unions and had a different cost base. So you can't look at Detroit. I always say, can't dump on the city completely and think that all of the city's challenges and problems were self-ordained. Got to admit about the self-ordained problems, but we have to understand the context of how national policies, fiscal policies, public policies, and trade policies do affect a city like Detroit. And I said it's either an aberration or it's a foreshadowing, because now we see in this post-recession arena, you see tremendous loss of home ownership and wealth. You see deteriorating infrastructure, you see high levels of poverty. And so the important thing I think about whether when we look at a Detroit, and a Detroit in terms of where it's come from, where it is, and the forces that have helped to rebuild a path forward, or you look at New Orleans and Katrina, is what are the best lessons? What are the best takeaways? How does that inform another community and their effort? And I think Detroit is unique for many respects, in many respects. So I think philanthropy and the business community can especially play a role when they not only bring, they can't just bring their money, but they gotta bring their money. And they can't bring their voice, but they've gotta bring their voice. And I think philanthropy and the business leadership is particularly impactful when they bring voice and when they bring money and when they bring intellectual capital to bear on a community's most difficult problems.
So Annise, Houston's a rather different place, some similar problems?
There's not a major American city that doesn't have some significant challenges, but I'm going to agree with everything that my fellow mayor just said, but to add on to it, it is about the individual dynamics of that particular crisis. It is about the individual dynamics of the personalities involved. I know that I just left office January 1st, so I'm still in withdrawals. and I have to say that last night, I was developing a tick. Every time somebody said, oh, you don't want to do business with the government because government's messy and inefficient. Okay, that's bullshit. Okay, excuse me. I'm from Texas, and that's a euphemism. So, democracy is messy. Democracy is slow. It is designed to be that way. And as many times as I wished that I could do away with my city council and just get things done, there were times that they did add value by bringing more voices into the process. But you cannot achieve without the political leadership. You have to have philanthropy. You have to have the business community. But you need the political leadership in place to carry out the new plan or the design or whatever you come up with. Houston has the benefit of hindsight because our crisis was in the 80s when the bottom dropped out of the oil market and we had our own mini depression, not a recession, but a depression in Houston. And we too were a one industry town. We were the headquarters of the world oil industry. We are still the headquarters of the world oil industry. I graduated from college in 1978, went into the oil industry, worked there for 20 years. It was 80% of the Houston economy. That is a recipe for disaster in any circumstance. Today, oil and gas is 40% of the Houston economy. Not because it has declined, but because we have aggressively worked to expand our other sectors. Medicine, the port, aerospace, manufacturing, and we have brought up those other sectors to compete and to cross-pollinate with the oil industry. And that took direct government leadership, but it also took the business community working to coming together in both a regional plan and a city-focused plan on how do we bring new businesses into the area, but also how do we work together through the philanthropic community in creating that new workforce to fill those new jobs we were trying to create, and also to integrate the new residents of Houston. One in four Houstonians is foreign-born. And I know that that's not the image of Houston that the rest of the United States has. We're better known across U.S. borders than across our state lines. And if the majority of the students in our schools speak English as a second language, that is a completely new set of problems that it's not a bad problem to have so much new blood attracting the best and the brightest from around the world, but it means that we have to work extra hard in order to integrate them and to make sure that our own kids, born and bred in Houston, and that our own communities of color who have not had an opportunity to grow into the new Houston economy are not left behind and overwhelmed by this new blood and these new initiatives.
So one of the things, not every town in America has a Rip Rapson. Not every town in America not only doesn't have his illustrative skills, but every town doesn't have the philanthropic community that he's a part of. Detroit had not only Kresge and Skillman and the Southern Michigan Community Foundation, I'm sorry if I botched the name, but also Ford's commitment to the city because of its history, although it had come and gone over the years. And it had a rather remarkable business investor who decided that there was both economic opportunity and mission in concentrating in that city. You know, I live and work in Washington, D.C., and in many ways it's a city with a great deal of vibrancy. But I will tell you that it does not have a philanthropic community anything like the one that is committed to Detroit. And its business community, which is a lot of service firms and real estate, which are national, doesn't have the same stake in our town that Detroit had in there. So, and I'd be curious, I mean, Derek, you're working in Chicago and obviously Houston, in different cities, and I'm sure the 12 other cities that are in this room probably have a different chemistry in the business community, the philanthropic community, and the capacity of the public sector. So how do you create the neural networks, the set of relationships? How do you deal with both the differences and try to build up the different legs of the stool to create a more effective cross-silo strategy? I mean, Derek, you want to start with Chicago ask others?
Actually, one of my takeaways from these last couple of days, as I heard about the role, and I knew some, but learned more about the role of philanthropy in the private sector and stepping up when the public sector was not strong and continuing to play this leadership role now in partnership, was the motivation for their activity, for their engagement, was not one of, this is a charitable thing, let's help out some folks in Detroit, the community, they're struggling, let's see what we can do. They were viewing this for themselves as existential issues. I was talking to him before for Rock Ventures and Dan Gilbert. They intentionally connected their future, their destiny, to the future and destiny of the city of Detroit. In Chicago, when you think about the South Side and the West Side, we don't have that yet. We have strong foundations, incredible foundations. We have strong private sector, but when you viewed it as this existential issue, you had this amazing alignment among these different sectors about how we're all going to do this together. If you look at the foundations in Chicago and you look at what they fund, it's kind of this, you know, you don't get that kind of overlap. So Joyce will have its priorities and MacArthur has theirs and the Trust has theirs. And if you're trying to do stuff, you have to appeal to what they're interested in. And I think what's been so powerful about Detroit, and is a lesson I'm taking back, is how do you get that alignment around vision, mission of those stakeholders who make those investments?
Nice. What's the infrastructure?
Never let a good crisis go to waste. I think it's part of the message here. But I mean, Houston has its old philanthropic families, and then the Houston Endowment, the Brown Foundation, the Cullen Foundation, and then the new money, the Arnold Foundation, the Kinder Foundation, and in addition, we had companies that were embedded in Houston, committed to Houston, and then we had our multinationals, and it is different if you have the multinationals or the ones that are spread across the United States, that your homegrown foundations, your homegrown companies that have made the commitment and see that they have a stake in the ground and they need to protect that, have a different attitude about investing. But one of the things I heard last night as part of the conversation was the idea that most foundations, when they give money, have the exit strategy in mind when they go in, and that mm-hmm. Kresge and others in this situation realized that they had made the commitment for the long term and they were going to be around. And I'm seeing that as well in Houston. The old Houston foundations, they are Houston foundations. Their money comes into Houston, but the new money, like the Kinder Foundation, is doing the same thing, but they're doing it in a way that binds the two partners together. Working with Kinder, they have created the Discovery Green Park under my predecessor. They worked with me to create the Buffalo Bio Park. We've now done a $250 million hike and bike trail expansion in the city, where the city committed $100 million and the private sector committed about $150 million with a lead gift of $50 million from the Kinder Foundation. And all three of those projects, the Kinder Foundation has made us contractually commit to maintaining what we build together. It's not a matter whether they go in, they give their money, and they have their exit strategy. They, you know, we build a project and then they're gone. They made me commit a revenue stream to enhance it, because we all know that one of the problems of dealing with cities is we like new shiny toys, we like to build them, and then we let them run down. And then we build new shiny toys and we let them run down. And they are trying to make us approach these kinds of projects and partnerships differently. So there are, you have to have both at the table, but there's new ways and different ways to look at it, and to have the philanthropic community not say, if you don't play the game I want to play, I'm going to take my money elsewhere, but to say, we're in this together for the long term. This is what makes both sides comfortable. Sort of a prenup for this relationship.
So I want to give you a couple of thoughts. So I'm a big believer, based on what I've seen, that it takes leadership from a business community perspective and a philanthropic perspective that will step up and rally those sectors. So in Detroit, you know, Dan Gilbert, and when he probably said he wanted to do something like this, people probably said, man, you crazy. You're not, how is this a sensible move? He projected himself in a disruptive fashion, took a risk, put his money out there. Certainly he saw a business opportunity, but he put his money out there. That kind of leadership is contagious. That kind of leadership compels others to act. Or a RIP stepping up and saying, look, we're going to make a big commitment to a collective, inclusive process to rescue Detroit. Others will follow in the philanthropic community. That makes a difference. When I was mayor, I had two or three business leaders that I built a very close relationship with, because I sensed and I knew that when they raised their voices, others will follow. Jim Bob Moffitt, right, who ran Freeport MacMoran, was a towering presence, a Texan. If he said, banged his hand on the table and said, guys, we got to do it, I got the first million. What do you have, what do you have, what do you have? We need to do this. He was willing to be bold and disruptive, and he didn't hold, he wasn't president of the chamber, he wasn't president of any, you know, traditional structure. He was willing to put himself out there. I've watched different models. So there's a model that operates in St. Louis. We have a big affiliate in St. Louis, and you had the Ferguson challenge. Well, St. Louis has an organization called Civic Progress. And that organization is made up of the larger businesses in St. Louis. They're very intentional about collectively working on projects and things and items. So one of the things they got heavily involved in after Ferguson is public policy, changing the laws in the Missouri State Legislature to restrict and put a cap on the ability of cities to finance themselves through municipal violations and tickets and fines and the like. You also had a business leader, happens to be the chair of our board, named Michael Neidorf. He decided he was going to build a facility in Ferguson. Right there in Ferguson, put 150 people to work. There are various models, but all of it is city specific. But they also involve a mechanism where business leaders and philanthropic leaders step up. Every single one of them, in my experience, is more comfortable if they have credible political partners. They've got a mayor or political leadership that they can engage with, that they can work with. Now, in my time in New Orleans, I was an African-American mayor dealing with business leaders who were white. So it was the politics of odd bedfellows in the racial dynamics of the city. So I did not have to worry, because of who I was, that working with these guys, I'd be perceived as a sellout. And they did not have to worry, because they were working with me, that if they supported the initiative, they were trying to dictate or control, right? Or be paternalistic in how they operated. And you cannot, in these communities, separate the necessity of thinking about the racial, political dynamics of inclusion and control. Every city has a different formula. Every city operates differently, but it's got to be top of mind that sometimes if we try to do something well, if we haven't thought out who's at the table and who's inclusive, a good move and the best intentions could backfire. And so that's a really important point. And so it takes that word bold. Urban leadership requires bold, disruptive leadership in the business community and in the philanthropic community, which many, many business leaders would be hesitant to do. But that's what we need more of in 21st century America.
But a crisis allows you to step out of your normal patterns. It focuses your attention. It allows you to think in new ways. You need something that hits the reset button, whether that is a crisis situation, new money coming in, or a significant change in leadership and personalities. And that could be at the political leadership or the business and philanthropic leadership. New person comes in willing to stand up and say, come on, guys, let's get this together.
Well, and one of the things, I think this point, that's right, the political leadership can also be a leverage moment, a focal moment for new money. I've noticed that it's hard to get national philanthropy focused on, interested in cities and the business community if they don't have enthusiasm about the local political leadership. So Matt, you guys came in at a time when there was not great enthusiasm about the local political leadership in the city, broadly, and you played an outsized role with other partners in some of the early planning around what the future trajectory and narrative for the city should be. So two questions. First, the Detroit Future City Plan, mm-hmm. and the fact that there was thinking going on about the future. What role did that play in your own thinking about confidence? And then the second question is, as the competency and focus on the questions that we're dealing with here of the public sector have risen, has that changed the way you think about your role in the community? And does philanthropy and the business sector kind of, if not take a back seat, sort of step into a different role?
Well, I think the Detroit Future City did play a role, but I don't know if it was, and I think it's a terrific initiative, as Rip knows and Tony. I'm a big fan of it, and I think it's tremendous. I think it's going to provide great guidance for us as we go forward. But I think what it did is it demonstrated that Kresge and other foundations were in the game. And that's really important. I mean, I've been working with the Kresge Foundation for a long time, and I was the chair of the Riverfront Conservancy, and we did the Riverfront together. But at the time, there was just the beginning of the evolution of philanthropy. At the time, they had challenge grants, and I'd always I have nightmares about my challenge grants, because it was always like, you have to raise X amount of money, and you have to go by the state, and you have to do this. And the reality in the flow, it doesn't work that way. And so if you look at the Riverfront, it had ebbs and flows. I mean, we're 10 years longer than we thought we'd be, or 5 years longer, and yet when you look back, you say, we're going to do 5.5 miles of perpetual public access, billions of dollars of development and everything else. And had we had a tactical grantor that wasn't in the game, it wasn't providing thought leadership, it wasn't a partner, we had no chance. And so I think that was probably the real compelling piece. And as far as, our engagement, we chose to engage. We thought we had a chance to do good and do well. I mean, we came down in 2010 at really the depths. I mean, by 2013, the bankruptcy, as someone commented earlier, we were happy. I mean, we had been bankrupt for 20 years. We just hadn't acknowledged it, right? We had been insolvent forever. We wouldn't take on the tough decisions to get it dealt with. And so it was a big deal for us. I think collectively, the crisis being the terrible thing to wait, all of us were able to really attack some of these things. I think it was important. I think what's evolved from that is an awareness that all three legs of the stool, if you will. I think it is a model that works in every community. I think it just is different at different times. I mean, I would call it more of a relay race where you got a baton and you hand it off from time to time. If there's any community where the mayor says, I'm the leader, you guys just follow behind me, I'm good. I don't think it's going to work. And I'd say the same thing about philanthropy or business. I mean, I think that in any healthy community, particularly as we go forward, when you have global competition, you've got this myriad of issues that are attacking you from all directions. You have different strengths, different skills, different concerns and backgrounds and experiences. You need to have a model that's flexible. I read in some of the materials an elastic kind of relationship where, you know, people are smart enough, they're strong enough, they're humble enough that they can play any of those roles at a moment's time, you know? I mean, and the reality is they all have to be there. And I think particularly in communities like Detroit and others perhaps where you just don't have the resources to be inefficient. I mean, you don't get many shots at this. And I mean, you know, many of us have been working in the city of Detroit for a long time. You know, it's been going downhill for 60 years. You know, there's been 100 different attempts to bring it back. We finally have a chance now, and I think people are like, you know, we can't blow this. And I think that allows you to build on the crisis, learn a little humility, get smarter about what other people's issues are, and create a path forward that that is that baton handing off where people can do that in a graceful way. And if there are problems or instances where the mayor's in a position or the leader's in a position where they need to be in front, well, that's fine too. I mean, you can deputize people sometimes too, and so it's still under your auspices. I mean, sometimes I think it's difficult when somebody's coming in from the outside and they got the idea, as the mayor said. I mean, it's got to be within sometimes the mayor's auspices, and I think that's fine too. I mean, again, if people are flexible and smart, I think there's lots of ways to do that.
So one of the things you've all talked about is that there is a kind of dynamic, you used elastic relationship between the different parties, you know, and over time those relationships build trust. And I think of it sometimes as synapses, the neural networks become stronger and strengthen, and that means when they have to deal with tough things, they're resilient to be able to deal with them. I think one of the things that we haven't talked about but is especially important to have trust in a conversation is around race. And the city of Detroit in particular has a history of both economic forces, but also a whole set of things in our society that created deep, pervasive, structural barriers to opportunity for African Americans. And essentially the city became increasingly concentrated as an almost exclusively African-American city, where the problems, where so many people fled the city. How do you deal with those racial dynamics, either in Detroit or in, I'm interested in some of the other cities, and particularly now, we heard a plea in yesterday's conversation to be explicit, to talk about both the racial history and think about race. Build enough trust that you can think and talk about race in solutions. How do we handle this racial legacy and address it in any of these cities as you're dealing with recovery? And in particular, as you make sure that, as you try to make sure that the long-term residents of a city who are in many cases that we're talking about here, Annise already referred to it, are often the African-American, residents have a chance to be part of what the flywheel brings into these communities. I don't know who
so
wants to start.
So Detroit, you know, one thing people have to acknowledge that for African Americans, Detroit symbolized progress. You had African American members of Congress elected in the 50s, elected in the 60s. One of the first big cities, along with Los Angeles and Atlanta, to elect an African American mayor. You had African American businesses grow up around the automobile industry. You had African American middle class grow up around the automobile industry. So when you compare the fact that many of the folks who achieved that success in Detroit were people from Mississippi, people from Alabama, sons of sharecroppers, grandsons of people that grew up in slavery, Detroit represented progress. It represented a better life. Their life in Detroit working in the auto industry in 1950, 1960, and 1970 was better than their parents' life picking cotton in Mississippi. You got to acknowledge that history. You've got to verbalize that history. You've got to acknowledge it, and you've also got to acknowledge that the forces of Detroit's decline were not just Detroit's making or just the, quote, making of the political leadership. Because when you say that, that's a racial dog whistle. That's how it's going to be received, guys, frankly and candidly. And so that's really, really important to recognize what Detroit, for all of its faults, for all of its challenge, what it represented to the people that came of age, came of power, came into the mainstream of Detroit in the 1970s and 1980s and the 1990s. So having said that, it's also important to recognize, as I said earlier, that forces beyond Detroit, Detroit was also a place of tremendous white flight to the suburbs, fleeing school desegregation. You've got to acknowledge that, because if you don't acknowledge that, it's difficult to build the future coalition that's inclusive. And then the second lesson is you have to be intentional about bringing people to the table. And you can't handpick leaders. You know, I can't say this business leader is my friend, therefore he's going to be the most important business leader in town. That person's got no following. They couldn't influence a fly. They can influence themselves. So you got to be intentional that when you build cross-sector leadership, and that's where democracy's messy, because it means you're going to have people in the room and at the table that are not going to agree. Now, I tried really hard to let the fussing and fighting happen in my office, right? I tried real hard to say, okay, guys, we got something we gotta argue about. Let's all get around this table, and we can curse each other out, cuss each other out, call each other names right back here. And let me try to see, after everyone is basically out of breath and tired, and I tried to play a little bit of a mediator a lot of times. Say, look, I'm hearing this and I'm hearing that, and how about this as a common approach or common identity? And so that's, you know, sometimes somebody's got to play that role. Maybe because of what I knew how to do when I was mayor, I could play that role. In some cities, a mayor may not be able to play that role. It really, really just depends. And so the racial dynamics have to be understood and acknowledged, and it means understanding that for all of its challenges and all of its problems, Detroit did represent. Look, African Americans left hard time Mississippi, lynchings, sharecropping, segregation, and they went to Detroit, and they went to Chicago, and they went to Buffalo, and they went to Rochester. And in all that cold weather, they earned more money, they had health care, they owned a house, they had an automobile. So acknowledging that history, to acknowledge it, also helps people acknowledge mistakes. So that dynamic is really, really important. And all too often, the transformation and change, and we do this as Americans, you see it being played out in the presidential campaign. We feel like we got to pin the tail on a donkey. We got to find somebody to blame. We got to throw somebody under the bus. And then once we throw them under the bus, then we can move forward. And I'm sort of arguing that, you know, to rebuild these communities, it's very, very, coalition building is difficult. Cross-sector coalition building is different. Multiracial is difficult. Look, Houston has Asian, Latino, African-American, and Anglo, right? You've got to have the skill set to bring people to the table. And sometimes that means stepping outside of traditional structures, because a lot of these traditional structures were built and designed when cities operated differently and when cities looked differently. So I think the racial dynamic, I think for the future of Detroit, I truly believe, and I've not heard, candidly, in the conversation about Detroit, anyone mention that one of the principles of the comeback of Detroit is diversity, right? That we're going to make sure that as we rebuild this city, that the jobs and the economic opportunity are going to be widely spread. You got to say it. I say it to corporate executives all the time. Diversity needs to be a cardinal principle, right up there with customer service, right up there with the best earnings. You got to state it so that people embrace it, so that it's a priority. And one thing leadership can do is set the priorities and set the tone and set the framework. Well, diversity is an inclusive kind of word. It helps people feel that this recovery and this rebuilding is part of it. Look, one of the most dramatic mistakes that was made in New Orleans, the most dramatic mistake that was made in New Orleans after Hurricane is that, this didn't happen on my watch, because it would have never happened on my watch, is that a group of business leaders went to Dallas, they had a meeting, and while in Dallas, they confected a plan to rebuild the city. And what the plan did is the plan was an intentional shrinking of the city to about half the population size and the bulldozing of about 50 to 60% of historic African American neighborhoods. Hmm. It went over like a lead balloon, but I wonder, because I know some of the business leaders and some of them had worked, what were they thinking that you could come up with a plan and put the stamp of the Urban Land Institute on it and somehow it would be embraced? It created a backlash. So what was the effect of it? The effect of it is that it delayed probably by 3 to 4 years the momentum necessary for a successful recovery. So that's why I think with all of these communities, Chicago, Detroit, you name it, you've got to think through at the beginning how you're going to ensure that the best plans are inclusive both in design and also in who will participate in carrying them out. And I think it's essential in 21st century America. I do not think anybody can lead in 21st century America without thinking about the complexities of racial dynamics and diversity.
Yep. So I wanted to ask about Houston and Chicago in particular, and each with very different challenges of inclusive growth and recovery.
Annise? You know, one of the things that struck me as Mayor Morial was talking is the major institutions of a city, and what we have seen over the last year and a half or so is what happens when you have a breakdown in the most important and most expensive function that cities provide. Well, actually, the most important function is clean water. We have Flint as an example of what happens when a city fails in that ultimate responsibility. But the other is police services and the legitimacy of police services. So you can't think about urban revitalization or economic development as its own animal. It is embedded in this context of the whole range of things that a city does and whether they do it well. And now, the good news for America is that there are thousands and thousands of cities across America, and most of them do an exemplary job every day because cities provide the services that human beings have in order to live together and survive. I mean, very basic. If the toilet's flush, it's a good thing. It's very basic services, and we do it very well, but we have had some Ferguson and Flint as examples of what happens when those very core governmental institutions fail to reflect either the community in which they serve or the principles that we believe are those that America stands for.
In Chicago. I mean, I'm sure all of you have been following, racial tensions are, you know, really, at least they seem to be at an all-time high or back to maybe high from prior years. And it's the result of the deterioration of certain parts of the city that seems to keep happening with no visible or articulated plan to really deal with it. The mayor, who I work with, I like the mayor, but obviously there have been some challenges there as well in terms of the trust between the mayor and people in the community over how certain situations have been handling, over the violence that seems to be spiking, no end in sight, jobless loss, population loss, and the like. And there is a feeling that you hear when I'm there about this notion of two cities. The people feel that there are two cities. There's the downtown that gets all the shine and the NFL draft and all that stuff, and then there's the south and the west sides that are struggling. And I would say, from the University of Chicago standpoint, you know, we're an anchor institution. Obviously, anchors played a major role in what's happening in Detroit. And we're doing a lot of work on the South Side. But there is also that feeling of we're the other players. Are we the only one? So that leads to significant racial tension and a lack of trust. I think some of the ways that you have to get at it, both Marc and Annise touched on, there's the acknowledgement of the past. I actually was speaking at a community meeting one time and talking about the University of Chicago. And the University of Chicago's history has ebbed and flowed. We started out as a very open, committed, being an urban institution kind of defined us. But there was a period of more retrenchment and urban renewal and things like that. And now we're in a new wave of being outwardly engaged. And I talked about that history, then I went on to talk about all the good things we're doing, and one of the community people said, you all need to start with the truth and reconciliation of the past. Until we have that kind of engagement with the university and the community, really laying out what happened, acknowledging it, literally a truth and reconciliation, we're never gonna get past and get to this period of trust. So I think acknowledgement is key. Another thing that I think is important is including all members of the community. And Marc, you were so right when you said you can't pick your leaders, because the natural tendency, it's just human nature, is when you're working on these difficult problems, you want to grab and work with the people who you see eye to eye. And when someone, it makes it very difficult for you, you tend to want to shy away. But a lot of times, the people who actually have the credibility in the neighborhoods, the credibility in the communities, are the ones that will push you the hardest. And so you can't just grab the usual suspects, have a meeting and say, well, I engage the community and put out the roster of the names, because people see right through that. And when we were doing work to bring the Obama Library, I heard that over and over. So you can't pick the leadership. But you have to engage, and a lot of what people want is really respect. They want to be a partner, and they want the respect of being treated and viewed as an equal to you. And if you have a university, a mayor, a foundation that approaches community as a superior, that engages when they need to engage, but doesn't give the respect, you're going to have a major problem. And I think one of the things that I've seen happening in Detroit, we're trying to do it on the South Side, was the community, you know, we talked about the three legs of public sector, private, and philanthropy, but the community was a strong leg, and the anchor institutions were the fifth leg. And my impression was that they all worked in partnership. You know, I'm sure there were lots of those kind of office meetings that you talked about where there was people challenging one another. But I think if you don't have that kind of inclusion from the beginning in the planning and in the implementation, it's going to be very hard to overcome those kinds of tensions.
There's, from a Houston standpoint, there's two things that make Houston different than any other big city in America. And one is we're the largest unzoned city in America. Our aggressive ability to annex. So the idea of capital flight to the suburbs, we just went and grabbed them and brought them back in again. And that is the reason that today the city of Houston is 640 square miles.
Wow.
Which is a big area in which to provide services, but the and yes, it's a headache sometimes to not have zoning, but what not having zoning has allowed is the redevelopment of neighborhoods very, very rapidly. So a neighborhood could be in decline, and then because of its proximity to some new commercial development or to downtown, in the case of older minority neighborhoods, suddenly they're hot commodity. And in those places where you have owner-occupied properties, It is a source of wealth. It's a source of community pride. In those neighborhoods where you have minority residents and no resident owners, you have gentrification and you wipe out whole communities really quickly. So it's a different dynamic and a different set of problems than happen anywhere else.
So I want to close, give each of you one final question, and also if they're going to, if anyone in the audience wants to ask anything, we'll be ready in just a minute. So as we've been talking about bold leadership, I want to ask about the next generation of leadership. I was excited this morning when I heard Tony say that how proud she was that a number of the people who had participated in the planning sessions went on to seek elected local offices in different communities. That was she argued, and I think rightly, that was a sign of success in that effort, that it helped to build. And so, but my colleague Rolf Pendel, who's here also, reminded me today that the demographics of these cities are changing in interesting ways, and some of the ways they're changing is they are aging. In other words, we're going to have a population that is going, for many of these cities, going to be older in norm, because so many of us are going to live a lot longer and require different things of our cities. So I'm curious, as we think about the next generation of leadership, how do we both build it in a way that is inclusive, that brings people from the community into the leadership roles, not just people that are anointed by the mayors, but people, those local leaders who challenge you the most. But how do we make sure also that leadership is representing a very increasingly diverse, and in some cases needing different things from their cities, generations in the city? And Matt, you might want to start, just as you guys have played a role in business community in building up some of its next generation of leaders.
Sure. Well, we probably do a couple of different things that I think are helpful in that regard. We really have spent a lot of time on bringing young kids into the city of Detroit and into our organization. So 3 or 4 years ago, we came downtown and we said, you know, what are we going to do to really have an impact on things? We were doing a lot of things from a business perspective, buying buildings and working on different things. But we said the most important thing we could probably do is expose young folks, bright young folks from across the country to what's going on in the city of Detroit and to our enterprise. And so we started a cadence of a couple years ago of 1,500 or more interns a year, 200 different universities and schools from across the country, across the world. We bring them into our company. They're sitting all over on the bouncing balls with laptops, and they just invade the hallways and everything else. And but it's terrific. I mean, we get all these great ideas. We bring, again, a large diversity of every type into this organization, and we expose them to the city of Detroit. And we send them out with interns from different places. We send them the ball game. We send them the DIA. We send them into the community to engage in different things. And I think it's been tremendously impactful to us as far as the things we've gained. And then I would add to that by some of the things that Kresge has done and some of the things that we're doing as well, which is sort of this, we talk about this relay race and the three-legged stool and the fact that people better be conversant with that. I mean, our people come in not just for the job, but for the mission. Derek made this point earlier. I mean, we're all in for the city of Detroit. We said, you know, our company is going to succeed or fail based on what happens to the city of Detroit. We have 15,000 team members down there now. We are all in. And so for us to be successful, we need to keep score, you know, with multiple bottom lines. And one of the bottom lines clearly is how the city of Detroit is doing and if it's healthy and so on. And so we spend a lot of time with that. And so I think in order to be successful, if you buy into the theory, which I do, that these characteristics of leadership and the types of from philanthropic and business and political, I really think a cross-pollinization is terrific. I mean, Kresge does the fellowship program, and they bring people in from across the country, and they put them into all these different areas, and then they move around from different sectors of the economy as well. And I think that's very profound. I think you create the kind of leaders going forward that think inclusive before they think historic confusion, and they think about the challenges that the other sector has to deal with in order to be successful, and they understand what they're dealing with, so they're more patient and sympathetic with that. And I think that kind of consistent focus, I think, is the right way to attack it.
Mark?
So I think all of these ideas are fantastic. So to not repeat, the key to me is this is a great place where the public and the private and the governmental sector can be intentional about initiatives around building future leadership. The sweet spot is to work with people who are in their early careers. They're just out of college, they're just out of graduate schools, they're early in their careers. And every community, there's so many of these regional leadership institutes and leadership institutes that are designed to prepare people for leadership. Where does a company come in by helping to identify young, rising executives and getting them involved in these sorts of things that many times lead to participation on civic boards in a community? I really think the intentionality, and I think this is a great place where cross-pollination takes place. It's also a great place where multi-sector and multi-racial leadership can be developed. Because if you get a group of people, let's say 100 under 35 young executives in any town together, and you identify them from different communities, and you bring them into a room, what you're going to find is that they will, in many instances, build relationships that are going to last a long time. They're also going to get an eye into perspectives and parts of the community that they may not understand and know. And I think that's really important. The key is to be intentional. About 15 years ago, it's almost 20 years ago, the National Urban League was facing this idea of becoming an organization that was historic and a legacy organization. And it was a definite thought process that it needed to develop a new, younger following. So we created the National Urban League Young Professionals. So now we've got approximately 60 chapters and about 7,500 people around the nation. They just, on their own, it was their idea, organized 100 of them to go to Flint, Michigan. They wanted to go to Flint. We got Walgreens to donate water. They went and distributed the water in Flint. They worked on a whole volunteer engagement. They did it themselves. They organized it themselves. They were the spokespersons for the initiative, all people under 35 years of age. So I really, really believe that we have to be intentional about building the next, if you will, generation of leadership, exposing them, involving them, giving them an opportunity. And I think when you do that, it will take care of itself.
Annise?
Sunbelt cities have a different problem than the older northeastern cities, and that is that we're very young cities and getting younger and browner every day. And one of the challenges, the city of Houston is approximately 42% Latino now. It used to be a biracial southern city, and in my lifetime it has become a multicultural, multiracial city, but 42% of the population of Houston is Latino, 12% of the vote. And that gap is really hard to get over. So you have to, if you're, and what it results in is a political leadership that does not look like the population. And so it means we have to wire around that by working extra hard to bring in our young Latino leaders into boards and commissions, to make sure they're in leadership organizations, to make sure their voices are heard when decisions are made, but it's often not through positional leadership, it's through situational leadership and intentional seeding of those conversations with the right people in the right place. But often it's somebody like me making the decision as to who those leaders are, and that's that's a pitfall that we have to watch for.
I would say that I think this question of leadership and capacity, both future generations but also existing, what exists right now, is one of the most critical issues facing the country at this time. I actually, when I was in the White House and would visit cities, you know, you have the high-profile cities, the New Yorks, the LA Chicagos, they have big departments and whatnot, but there's hundreds of cities where they're completely strapped at a capacity level. There's virtually no bench. to take jobs if one person leaves. One person is playing five different roles in the city. And we all know what's happening with urbanization. More people are going to be going to cities. They're going to become more important. And if the United States doesn't get on top of this issue of developing the capacity, and not just city governments, this has to also happen in the neighborhoods, community-based infrastructure. If we don't get on top of that, we're going to be in big problems. And when people talk about cities and what's important to cities, they always talk about education and crime and economic development, this and that. This issue has to be right there with it. And I say it for two reasons. One is that we all can develop plans. I think that, you know, one of the things, like when I was in the White House, we were always putting out grants for plans. And now that I'm in this, working on the ground, there are a lot of people who are expert at planning. When you want to find experts at getting stuff done, how do you implement? Crickets. That doesn't exist.
To plan,
it doesn't exist.
To implement is divine.
And part of it is because we don't have the capacity. Now, if you don't have the capacity, what happens? Your neighborhood doesn't, no one comes in to do it. What ends up happening is philanthropy, the city, your community doesn't get the funding because they say, there's no one for us to give it to. So you have a continuation of the haves and the have-nots. The other issue is sustainability. I remember when I was doing an urban tour and we had a group of mayors when I was in the White House, and I was talking about sustainable communities and promise this and choice that, and this mayor said, everything you say sounds phenomenal. The vision you're laying out is tremendous. But I have one person in my planning department. How is what you're laying out, the resource you're providing, relevant to me at all when I have no capacity to do anything you're talking about? And, you know, with Detroit, you have to, some point, as someone said earlier, there's time scales to these investments. And thank goodness you have Kresge and you have what Dan Gilbert and them are doing, and they're in it for the long haul. But someone's got to be carrying it out. You have to have sustainability. So I would like to see the philanthropic community of the country come together, just like they did with Art Place. When Rocco Landersman got them all together, I was in the White House, they all came and met the president, and they pulled together to deal with the issue. We need a national movement. I've challenged the foundations to lead it. Get with Sean Donovan before he goes. See if you can get something out of him. But we have to attack this issue for our current state and for the future.
So, since there is as much capacity in this room for the future of cities as there is anywhere else, I thought what we might do, we have only 5 minutes left, is see if we want to get three either questions or comments, and we'll see if we have time to answer them, but to any reactions to this larger discussion or questions as well, and we'll take all three of them and then we'll see how we close. And if we, please.
I just have one brief comment, but in both panels today, this has been excellent, and I'm just honored to be here. But what I haven't heard is I think there's a fourth leg of the stool, and that's the nonprofit sector. And we say civic leaders every once in a while, but I think we should be explicit about that. I mean, one in every five a person in Wisconsin is employed by a nonprofit entity, and I think it's often not seen as the power force that it really deserves. So. That's just a small comment, but thanks very, very much for the whole day.
And all the business development and social services, yep, and all of the things we were talking about, in fact, are absolutely usually brought to us.
Point
by
really
the
well topics. Made. Point well made.
Others? Reactions, comments, questions? We have one over there and one over here, so I'll point Bill Diggy.
We had a question. Right? Mine? No, go. I've got there first.
I hear.
No.
Oh, I see over there. Okay. I'm sorry. Oh,
this question, you mentioned the truth and reconciliation question. Kim Heron from Kresge, you mentioned the truth request for truth and reconciliation kind of process and some of dealing with the past. Where do you actually take those comments? What happens? How do you follow on that?
So it was funny because when we were having this conversation with the community person, she's a leader in the neighborhood, we were kind of going back and forth, debating. It was a healthy debate, but we were discussing it for some time. And I personally am open to the idea. I think that, there's some who want to be more forward-looking. There's a tendency to think about, what was done in the past. I wasn't part of it. Look at what we're trying to do now. Can we prove by our actions? I think that there's something there. Where I would take it, though, is I would need, what she's talking about is not something that just I could do. It would really take kind of a university. I would need to get the institution behind this notion of engaging with the community in that kind of forum. And so there would need to be first some internal process and work done to get the buy-in for it, but then to take it to the community. There are opportunities, though, that could come up that would lend themselves to that. One being, we have the Obama Presidential Library coming. And it's coming to the south side of Chicago. The University of Chicago led an effort. It was a community-based effort to bring it. And as that's coming, a lot of questions now are being asked about, what's that going to mean for the community? How do we want to think about what's happened historically around development when community was excluded? How do we make sure that doesn't happen now? Gentrification, the whole nine. And so I think there's a conversation that could be had and needs to be had about how do you grow inclusively, how do you reconcile for the past and learn in a trusting partnership to move forward together that could lend itself to that. So that might create an opportunity.
One thing I just mentioned, we're going to host next week with our board, Secretary of Transportation Fox. And one of the things that Secretary Fox has done that is really quite unusual, and I encourage people to look at the website, is he started talking about the role that highway placement and sidings played in almost all of our cities in not only, in many cases, wiping out low-income and communities of color, but also in physically creating barriers to keep those communities separate from other parts of our cities. And I know I was at HUD in an earlier era when we were always a little bit uncomfortable talking about FHA's role in having segregated the suburbs. It's a hard thing when you run an agency to stand up and talk about your own agency's role in discrimination in the past. And so I really, what Secretary Fox is doing is he's talking explicitly using his own hometown about the role that the transportation played, and then he's talking about how do we, in our next set of investments, make sure that that investment is done in an inclusive way. And in many cases, he's using some of the Raj Chetty work and the affirmatively furthering fair housing regulatory opportunity as enthusiastically as the folks at HUD are doing to try to think about making that change. And it's a nice combination of the past and the future together.
But you have to do the combination. Yeah. It's like having a wound that's festered. You have to open the wound up and you have to clean it out before the new tissue can grow over it, which is why a lot of times you want to have those truth and reconciliation commissions. And it is something that we've done a bit in Houston. I would point out that we have not had a racially motivated riot in the city of Houston, I'm not knocking on wood here, since the 70s. And one of those reasons is that we do a lot of talking, but it's always in, yes, this happened, we're gonna acknowledge this happened. If we have a video, we release the video right away. We don't try to sit on it and we let it out. But then we pivot away. But we pivot away from that to what can we do together to do better? Not just what happened. What are we going to do next? And you have to have real things that you can do immediately.
I agree completely.
So we had one comment back there, and then I think we're going to turn it over to our wrap.
We have a two-part question. First, directly to the mayors in particular, I'm curious with all of the re-urbanization that we've heard so much about today, one of the systems that we haven't talked a lot about that have a huge impact in cities and urban areas is the public education system, which is in most cases far outside of the direct control of mayors. So I'm curious, as you look out into the future as mayors, as former mayors, what do you see as the role of mayors in the public education system in our urban areas where unquestionably we have failing systems in many cities?
No mayor can be successful without a good school system, but it's for most of us, it's a situation where we have no authority whatsoever, but all the responsibility.
You know, there was a move, it sort of began really in Chicago with Rich Daley. Mm-hmm. For mayors, and he promoted it very aggressively, the idea that because schools and education was so important, the mayor should have a larger say in public education. And a lot of cities follow that route. I tell people all the time, if you like the mayor, you like mayoral control. If you don't like the mayor, you don't like mayoral control. It's right. Really that basic. Right? It doesn't have anything to do with anything else. But it's crucially important. But I also believe that for public urban education, this is where philanthropy and the business community have to really intimately be involved. You know, I learned something tragic after the Freddie Gray incident in Baltimore. And you know, you go and say, well, what's really going on in this community? And they say, well, let us tell you a little bit about some of the high schools. How over the last few years, they've basically stripped away all of the extracurricular activities. So why have they stripped away the extracurricular activities? Well, they've had a 10% funding cut this year and a 5% funding cut last year, and you know, we're just spending less money on schools because that's all we have. A tragedy, right? So this issue, broadly defined of youth, of which education is a central component, is also, we haven't had a chance to talk extensively about it, is a very important element of a healthy city. And schooling is essential and it's pivotal, but it goes far beyond schooling. It goes to the entire ecosystem that supports children and supports families and supports parents, creates a magnet away from all of the problems, whether it be violence or any other issues that occur. So I think that people, you know, the jury is out on whether mayors being in charge of schools has made a significant difference. I think the jury's out. And I think what that tells you is that some of the challenges of public education are more structural. They're less about who's in charge and more about the strategies, the funding, and the approaches we take to educate our kids.
So we are two-part question, part two.
Okay, hi, part two. So I'm gonna say what Matt Cullen can't say, which is that Quicken's investments in the city have been just totally fantastic across the board, from the interns to the investments in the buildings to all of the nonprofit work, but and every city would be doing much better. Every city needs a Quicken and a Rock Ventures. But I think a lot of the investments that I see that your company has been doing, Matt, is in the nonprofits themselves, and a huge amount of intellectual contribution to strengthening nonprofits. And I would just call out the Detroit Land Bank as just something we haven't talked about too much, but the Detroit Land Bank is, I think, by a factor of 10, the biggest land bank in the country, and is going to be totally critical to Detroit's success. And your company has been investing just tremendously intellectually to helping the land bank get off the ground, since it's essentially a startup and the biggest. And I don't know if you want to talk, I hear the panel talking obviously about leadership, but also about implementation. And I think that the work that Matt has been doing is critical to getting lots of these great initiatives done.
Well, thank you very much. No, I think that's absolutely right. I mean, and the mayor made the point earlier that it's fine to contribute money, but it's equally or more important to contribute, you know, your engagement. And that engagement could be intellectual capacity, it could be just political support, it could be a lot of things. Air cover for a politician. I mean, I mentioned the same thing relative to Kresge and the foundation community. I mean, when you're a passive player, and Derek, I mentioned this too, in Chicago, I mean, it's great that somebody puts $1 million into something, and that's terrific. But in many instances, particularly when you're engaging with the public sector, they don't have that capacity. And you mentioned it with the Choice Neighborhoods, and And obviously, you've been involved with that as well. I mean, they simply don't have the capacity. And so even to give them a check, I mean, it takes them a year to hire somebody and to try and ramp up with the technology and everything else. And there might not be a better example of that than a project that many of us worked on together with the blight report in the city of Detroit, where the White House was involved and everybody else was like, hey, blight's a problem. But the city literally had no capacity to try and understand it. So Kresge got involved, and Rip and Laura and Wendy and a bunch of folks, the business community, the city. And we put technology in place that in the course of 9 days, we did a physical assessment of every parcel property in the city of Detroit, 381,000 parcels. We knew the condition of them, we knew who owned them, we knew who paid taxes on them, we knew everything else. And that allowed us to make some profound decisions that had wide impacting outcomes from a blight elimination. We were able to get some more hardest hit funds because we were able to demonstrate that it was real. So I think that's right. And it comes back again to my earlier point about the baton of leadership. I mean, you need to be able to collaborate on that. And at particular times, I mean, we, the business community, the philanthropic community, were able to lead in the creation of the approach and the data and everything else. But then it was clearly up to the mayor to lead on the implementation and getting it done. So I think you're absolutely right. I think Goldman Sachs, JP Morgan Chase, a lot of people are doing the same thing, and I applaud it because it's really difficult to be successful without it.
With that, I think we're going to turn it over to our managers to tell us what we learned today and also invite us up to perhaps the next more liquid part of the program. But before I do that, can you please join me in saying thank you to this extraordinary group?
This issue of leadership has sort of permeated today. While we started with an opening plenary focused on it and ended with another one, it also was in the middle of all the other conversations that were about inventive structures and approaches. So as I think about this, I'm going to be really brief because the man who makes pictures is going to connect all the dots for us. And that is simply, there are sort of three sort of bigger lessons about what looking at Detroit means to me and my work about philanthropy and government. The first is, in philanthropy, we often talk about policy change and systems change, but we usually mean health systems or education systems. And as we have been doing this work, Elwood and I, what's become apparent to me that there's this rebirth or re-interest in place-based philanthropy. But it really is geography as a system, which goes back to your diagram with the nine pillars in building a city. It's a system. So that's the first point. The second, that governing, sort of making collective choices to solve public problems, is really a blend of both formal and informal institutions. We have a couple of people in my profession, economics, who have won the Nobel Prize by their study of how informal institutions reinforce the rules and regulations of formal institutions. And that's exactly the role that philanthropy and the private sector play. They can support the formal institutions of government, but to really solve a community's problem, you need all three, which is what we just talked about. And then the final point that I just want to sort of call out is that we understand now that leadership is not about formal powers. It's often about soft power. My colleagues in international relations and public diplomacy often talk about the importance of relationships and networks and being able to tell stories to move to action. So those are sort of three themes that we've discovered or sort of seen revealed in this sort of study of Detroit, but are really larger issues about how society creates change. And with that, I want to bring up Rip. I want to give my own introduction to Rip. At Brookings, Amy sort of talked about him as sort of a blend of Minnesota nice and Midwest grit. what I sort of see on Rip and sort of his leadership at Kresge, but even before that, is someone who has a vision and also the tenacity to sort of get it done.
I think I'm actually not going to try to connect the dots. I think I'm going to leave that to all of you. I will say that I have, I don't know about the rest of you, but I've been just sort of blown away by the quality of these conversations. When we first imagined this the better part of a year ago, I think we were genuinely not sure that this thesis made sense, that there really was an element of exceptionalism to Detroit, and that to try to stretch that too far really would sort of work against common sense and work against the sort of the pragmatic realities that everyone in this room brings to the situation. And I think when we sort of took it apart and put it back together, it was hard to know kind of how to really sort of stress test the proposition. Would you do it from a leadership perspective? Would you do it from sort of a philanthropic engagement perspective? Would you talk about the sort of the component bedrock conditions that a community needed? And what I think the last, it seems like last 3 weeks that we've been in this room, I mean the last couple of days has shown, is that it is, of course, all of those things. And it is both, as has been said many, many times, it's both the exceptional and the emblematic circumstance. I also think that in a conversation like the ones we've had over the last day, you often get a lot of sort of information and noise overload. I think what we've gotten here is a set of idea and insight overloads, and that's why I think I'm not going to try to torture you all with the 8 or 9 themes that pop out at me. But I think my sense is that what comes out of this is a sense of collective intelligence and compassion around issues that we're all holding together. And so in my view, the exercise has really been worth it. We've learned an enormous amount. I have not had the chance to talk with our staff, but I can't imagine that we don't come back enriched and enlightened. I'm only hoping that it works the other way, because in some ways we're not through. We have tomorrow the opportunity to have the 13 communities gather together. I think we'll try to do that in a way that sort of raises up issues from these last couple of days of conversation that seem to be resonant for you, and see whether there might be something done about it. What that might be, whether it's a set of resources or additional convenings or whatever form it might take, is I think what we'll try to pursue. And then again, I think what we will try to do is not end there either. I think what we're hoping to do is figure out what then we might do if a group of us or a group of others could come into some of your communities and try to give some of the same kind of support that we've felt so enriched by in Detroit. Because I think one of the things I come away with is what Benji said earlier on, is that when you look at the sort of the array of folks who came to Detroit to contribute time, money, ideas, energy, it is just profound. It takes your breath away. And there's no reason in the world that we can't have some variation on that in every community in this room. So we'll do that. Let me just say that I've been to a lot of conferences. We all have. And I think the structure and the choreography of this has been just impeccable. And so, Jim, you and your staff, I just really want to thank. It's really been remarkable to look at 4 panels, 1 emergency manager, 6 TED Talks, and 3 breakout sessions, and to actually discern any coherence from that is quite remarkable. So, Jim, thank you. But but forgive me, because there is sort of one person on our side of the ledger who I think deserves equal billing, and that's Chantel Rush. Chantel. That was the most extended applause anyone got today, Chantel. That was great. I think it's because Chantel has been on the phone to every single one of you at least three times, trying to make sure that it has all worked out for you. And you haven't seen the last of her or heard the last from her. And I think that's very good news indeed. She's one of the most talented, extraordinary people I've had the privilege of watching work in our field for a long time. So thank you very much. So I hope you will stick with us. It's just been an honor to be a part of these conversations with you. I hope that where we go from here is equally beneficial and productive, and I hope we'll all have the opportunity to sort of gather back together very soon. So please go have a drink, and I hope to see many of you tomorrow. Thanks.